So he'd come up and he'd knock the piss out of you at some point in practice. So you had to come ready every day. But he took it serious. Okay? He's a really good friend of mine. He's in the private sector now, as we like to call it. He's in the business world. He runs ultra marathons. He's one of the toughest people I've known in my whole life. And he's going to come speak to you guys for a minute. Please sit up in your chairs. Get your feet off the chair in the front. Get your eyes on him. Give him the respect he deserves. All right, Steve Camp.
So unfortunately, that's one of the few promises the man actually ever kept. have supportive coaches, I enjoyed sports. I was very, very fortunate. I had a lot of great coaches and male figures in my life that invested in me. I was able to learn all the things that you take with you throughout your football or athletics career, then into coaching and really into the workforce. And I'll talk a little bit about that later on, about the transferable skills that you've already learned and you may not even know it yet. But I learned the importance of hard work, consistency, accountability, all the things that we'll touch on a little bit this afternoon. Right, from those guys, not a father figure that was in my home, but from the coaches that served that purpose or older brother type. So I ended up turning myself into a halfway decent player, never was the most talented, never been the most intelligent, did a little bit of everything, right? Just kind of slightly above average. I was a full scholarship Division II player. I went to college, played there, started for 2 years, and I said, you know what? That's not football to me. I had dreams of playing Division I football. Much like many of you walking out of high school, you said, man, I'd love to be at that time, for me, it was Florida State and Miami, right? I was watching that. I was watching the Virginia Tech game because that's where I'm from. Of course, for you guys, it's Georgia Tech or all of these SEC battles, things of that nature, right? So that was football to me. Just coming off the Michael Vick years at Virginia Tech. And so I said, you know what? I'll go walk on. I'll take my opportunity and take my chances there and try to earn a scholarship, try to earn playing time against the nation's best. So I went there and walked on to Virginia Tech. And one of the great things about that was, like Coach mentioned, you meet some great people, you meet like-minded people, like these guys in this room right here, who all have the same mission. That's to be great, be the best that you can be, right? So, played for a Hall of Fame football coach, Coach Frank Beamer. He got inducted into the Hall of Fame this year. So, was fortunate enough to learn a lot about winning. What it takes, the sacrifices that are involved in that. Much like you guys are doing right now, when you're asked to do things that might not be comfortable, that's part of your culture, that's part of those sacrifices that you have to make in order to achieve a goal that you have, and that the coaches have for you, that vision, and we'll talk about that in a second. So I worked hard. Coach has mentioned a few of my highlights there. Practice was my Super Bowl, guys. I got a chance to play a decent amount as a senior, but never as much as any of us want to, right? You'd like to be a starter, play all the time, be an all-league guy, whatever it is, all right? So we had to hit this, and I did some things to make that fun for me and to be competitive in practice. But the greatest thing was I earned a reputation there as a guy that's probably going to be a halfway decent football coach. So they offered me an opportunity to stay on there as a football coach. And that started really what ended up being a 12-year coaching career for me. Coached at the high school level, coached at the college level for a number of years, and had an opportunity to coach some of the nation's best. Percy Harvin was one of mine in high school, Todd Boyd, you might be familiar with some of those guys. And so, had a great career. They make you a lot better coach, I promise you. Guys like some of you guys walking in this room who are elite football players make all these coaches better coaches, all right? But I had a lot of fun doing it, and again, learned a lot about winning. Took my L's too. A lot of peaks and valleys in life, man. You got that, you gotta get used to it. 1 year, you're the championship level, right? Coaching the player of the year as a quarterback at Norfolk State University. The next year I'm at Rhode Island, we're 0-12. I didn't forget how to coach, man. Not in a 5 month period, right? But unfortunately, there's some peaks and valleys that are involved in life. You gotta be able to overcome those. We'll talk just a little bit about that as well. So, got fired at the University of Rhode Island. The head coach got let go, and so that meant the whole staff does. This is how college football works. And moved into, as Coach mentioned, the private sector. Moved into the business world, and actually realized that all the stuff that coaches have been preaching to you for the longest of time, or your parents, or your guardians, or your grandma, whoever is involved in your life that's been telling you, be places on time, do the right things, Those are transferable skills to any career, any industry, anything that you pursue. Anything that you pursue. Because again, most of you won't go to the NFL, most of you won't go into coaching, you'll go in and get a regular job and go into the private sector. All those things are still gonna be important. And we'll touch on just a few. All right, so culture. And that's enough about me. You know, I don't tell you about all my accomplishments really. To brag, it's more so that I'm living proof that regardless of how you start, it's about how you finish and how you progress to that. I have 3 degrees. I've got 2 master's degrees. I've got my undergraduate degree. And by no means am I the most intelligent. I'm just willing to work hard enough. Hard work is still undefeated, man. It's still undefeated. So I'm living proof standing in front of you. Culture. You got your behaviors within an organization or a team, right? Vision, values, norms of that same organization. So there's a famous quote out there from a motivational speaker, Peter Drucker. He says, culture eats strategy for breakfast. And that probably doesn't mean a lot to you right now. But your culture, how you go about your business every day, whether you're on time, whether you wear the right things to practice, and you do the things that Coach talks about, and that you rally for the guy next to you, the parts that are involved in the culture, is much more important than the plays you run, guys. It's much more important than what we call a third down. I can assure you, there's no play, there's no magic in the playbook. It's all about the culture and the things that are associated with how you go about your job and how you focus on winning each day. All right? So that's part of the culture there. So one of the characteristics I want to talk about, discipline. So for those coaches in here, that all of us that have children, we think discipline is a little different sometimes, right? We're talking about, I've got two young sons, so discipline, I'm thinking, I got to get after them a little bit. But here I'm talking about self-discipline. Some aspects of self-discipline. Consistency. Are you the same guy every day? I can assure you, and again, you hear this when you're watching and listening to Monday Morning Quarterback or whatever it may be. What is one of the major evaluation points that they make of any famous player? Consistency, right? That's why they say Tom Brady's great. Some of these other players that have always done it, Michael Jordan, whatever it may be. Consistency. Look how many years LeBron's played in the finals, right? Are you the same guy every day? Because everybody can be good one day a week. Can you do it every day? Dependability. Can we trust you? Can we lean on you? You want to know why you're not getting the ball on third down? Maybe you're not dependable enough yet. Maybe you haven't proven it every day in practice out here on this turf, out on the grass, whatever it may be, you're in camp, right? So it's about being dependable. So I live in Rhode Island now. I wasn't born a Patriots fan of any kind, but when you're up that way, you certainly have to respect the organization. I know many of you are probably Falcons fans. I apologize for talking about the Patriots. And again, I'm not a fan. But when you look at their organization, you talk about dependability. There's a lot of guys on that roster. Julian Edelman, Wes Welker years ago, right? Danny Woodhead. Some of you may not even know who the hell Danny Woodhead is. He probably sells a shirt. Right? But understand, why did they survive in that organization? Because they were consistent and dependable, right? And then they go some other places and maybe they don't appreciate that portion of it. What does Bill Belichick say? The thing that's the most, more important than ability is dependability. So he's going to take the guy that's more dependable over the guy that runs faster or whatever it may be. All right? And that's why they survive in that organization and usually thrive there. A lot of guys are going, who was that again? Chris Hogan? Not even sure. Catches some critical passes in the Super Bowl, right? So think about that as well. Motivation. Some of you may see a lot of stuff on some Inky Johnson stuff, a little motivational stuff online. It's everywhere, right? But as they talk about, motivation wears off. It's all about self-discipline. Because you're not always going to be motivated. This is the biggest test of your self-discipline is camp, right? This is not what normal human beings do, guys. You're a different percent, man. And you have to approach it that way. This is hard. If it was easy, there'd be another 150 people sitting in this room with you. All right? So this is a test of your self-discipline. Motivation wears off, man. You need to work to establish discipline to make sure you're consistent, dependable. So quick story, this hit national news a couple years ago. James Robinson, he's from Michigan, right? Detroit, Michigan. So when I think of Detroit, Michigan right now, honestly, I think of cold, and I think of crime over the years. Those are the two things I think of, right? So James Robinson, back in 2005, he was 46 years old. He was driving a 1988 Honda Accord. His 1988 Honda Accord breaks down. James works at a factory in Detroit. He makes $10.55 an hour. It's not a lot to live on, guys, depending on what, maybe if it's your dual income or whatever it may be, not this time, this day and age. So James can't afford to fix the 1988 Honda Accord. So what does he do? James got to be at work. He walks 10 miles to work. Gets off at 2 a.m., what's he do? He walks home, another 10 miles, through some of the roughest neighborhoods in Detroit, Michigan. Does that for 10 years, 5 days a week, guys. Does it for 10 years. Why? You think he was motivated? No, the guy had discipline. He's consistent, he's dependable. So most people, when I tell that story, they say, man, he probably took a lot of days off, right? No. During that decade, he won awards for attendance and performance during that decade. So if that's a challenge to you, think about the next time you say, man, I don't know if I can make it to class today. I don't know am I going to give it my all, or am I going to be on time to practice? Whatever it may be, whatever that challenge is, are you consistent? Are you dependable? Think about James Robinson. The guy walked 20 miles round trip to and from work, 5 days a week for 10 years. Thank goodness it hit national news. They ended up raising a bunch of money for the guy, got him a car. So think about that when you think self-discipline versus this whole motivation thing. All right, next characteristic, accountability. That's another buzzword you probably heard a lot, accountability. We're all accountable to someone, guys. Any of us married men here, we know, right? You're accountable to your spouse, you're accountable to your coaches, you guys sitting in this room. Most importantly, you're accountable to the guy sitting next to you. So in 2014, they polled all military personnel in the United States, and they asked them a bunch of questions. There was a few that stuck out. They asked them, hey, what do you think about when things get difficult? Who do you fight for? So a lot of people were shocked when they heard, instead of, hey, I fight for the flag, I'm U.S., I'm a proud American, all these things, they say, I fight for the guy next to me. Strengthen the unit. They're not thinking, when bullets are flying, they're not thinking about the flag, guys. They're not thinking about, hey, it's great to be an American. They're saying, man, that guy next to me, this is the most critical aspect of it. When the bullets are flying, I got to take care of the guy next to me. He's taking care of me. Accountability to the guy next to you. Strengthen that unit. And that applies as much to this sport as any. So 11, you got 11 guys out there, all have to be in cohesion, right? Fighting for the guy next to them. So great quote there. A true soldier fights not because he hates what's in front of him, but he loves what's behind him. So again, it's all about those guys in this room, and coaches included, right, that are all fighting for the same mission, same goal, and then there's strength in the unit. Team first mentality. As I mentioned earlier, Coach talked about, hey, I didn't play to tell you guys, I wasn't a starter, I wasn't a great player. I played against some of the nation's best, and you know what, I just wasn't good enough. But at the end of the day, I had a team first mentality. I didn't go to work every day saying, oh, man, I wish I was playing more. I said, you know what, I'm gonna hit a guy in the mouth, and let's see what happens. And if I get an opportunity to play more because I bled somebody up, that's what I'm gonna do. You gotta have a team first mentality. You may not be playing the position you wanted to play. You may not play as much yet. You earn that through consistency, dependability, getting after somebody every day. You try that and see how things go. Your career will change. Story to back this one up. So, 1996, right here in Atlanta, Georgia. 1996 Summer Olympics. Great Britain men's crew team. Some of you out from the South too, or at least mid-Atlantic, right? I don't want to offend anybody. But I didn't know what the hell crew was either. Guys, that's rowing. Guys that row, right, get on the boat. So the men's crew team, it's an Olympic sport. eight guys in the boat, the ninth guy's yelling at them, right? They came in eighth place in the Summer Olympics, Great Britain. Eighth place. Which out of all the countries that compete, eighth place is not bad. But they had a goal of winning gold. So they had a strong nucleus of guys coming back. So they got together after they get back from the Olympics, they say, hey man, what can we do to get over the hump? How do we go from eighth to gold? So they came up with a motto. Will it make the boat go faster? Will it make the boat go faster? So much like you guys, Olympians, a lot of them, hey, they live together, right? These guys are training together. How many years between Summer Olympics?
4 years,
guys. So for 4 years, every time a guy did anything, he said, hey, will it make the boat go faster? So when you're thinking about going out on Thursday night, sneaking out, maybe using drinking alcohol, whatever it may be, knowing that your performance on Saturday may be compromised, what should your roommate say to you? Will it make the boat go faster? Hey, is that going to help us win game number one? Anything you do, you should be able to be held accountable to the guy next to you. That's what we're talking about. Accountability amongst each other. Somebody should be able to hold you accountable without you getting upset and taking it personal. You should say, you know what, you're right. Will it make the boat go faster? So these guys said that to each other for 4 years, man. 4 years. Sydney, 2000 Sydney Olympics, they win gold. They won gold. So obviously there was a lot of hard work in there, but these guys credit this motto of holding each other accountable, because this sport, much like our sport here at football, if one guy's out of their gap, first down, right? There, one guy slows down, that boat slows down, and they don't win gold. That's the difference between eighth place and gold, man. So think about that when you're looking at the guy next to you, strengthening your unit, and say, hey man, I'm accountable to you, but you're also accountable to me. And is it going to make the boat go faster when you're out chasing skirt up until midnight or whatever it may be when you should be at home getting yourself ready and prepared for practice and those things. All right, so think about accountability in that way. Next characteristic, elite mindset. How you do anything is how you do everything. Let me repeat that. How you do anything is how you do everything. And coaches preach this all the time, man. If you don't think that what you do on a Monday impacts what you do on Saturday, you're lying to yourself. Whether that's weights, whether that's just video, whether that's practice, how you do anything is how you do everything. So when the coaches or the training staff, whoever it is, ask you to carry some things in from practice field, how you do that determines and it shows those coaches what kind of character you have on how you're going to do things when maybe you're the starter. Maybe you're an all-league player. Those small things are just as important, guys. How you do anything is how you do everything. 1% better every day. You guys have heard that before. What are you doing to progress? Do you just watch film when you're supposed to watch it with your coach? Or is there more film to watch? Are there some things that you can learn and progress with, right? Maybe you can get a little extra work in the weight room. I mean, they designed a program to get you some rest, right? No doubt about that, so make sure you're doing that as well. But are you fighting to be 1% better? Are you working on your technique every single day you're out there? In the private sector, I always challenge people, are you listening to podcasts, are you reading or listening to audio books, reading, doing those things that can really help you? You could be doing the same thing, guys. I can guarantee you, if any interest you have, whether it's interest beyond football, there's probably a podcast, or there's a book out there, there's a video. If you've got a smartphone, which I would assume every guy in this room has one, you've got access to internet, you've got access to video, right? You've got access to anything right there on that phone. Use that to challenge yourself to get better. Don't text and drive, though. You listen and watch a video. So here's a quote here. Some of you may have heard this. Denzel Washington said this at his acceptance speech before. But this is a great message to some of you veterans, that things have gotten a little easier to you, right? this quote here, ease is a greater threat to progress than hardship. Ease is a greater threat to progress than hardship. Guys, what do we all do when things start going wrong? Usually, we rally together, right? Somebody in your family is sick, some sort of diagnosis, everybody rallies, say, let's raise some money for them, let's do this, let's go here. There's a sense of urgency. But once you get to where everything starts to slow down to you a little bit, maybe just have and you think it's a little easier, now you've got that ease. That can be a threat to your progress. Make sure you veteran players don't fall into that trap. That's a trap, guys. That's fool's gold. It's not easy. It might have gotten easier. Think about how much better you can be. Kyle Rock. So, talking about consistent and persistent action. So this goes along with your mantra here. You guys, your motto this year, win the day, right? Win the day. Kyle Rock. So I became familiar with Kyle Rock years ago. Coach John Gruden was the head coach at Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and this was one of the sayings they had. I adopted this years ago when I was a head coach and really throughout my coaching career. But it means the same thing. Are you willing to pick up that sledgehammer and keep hitting that rock every single day? Every day. Remember, that rock, that symbolizes life, man. That's class. That's football. Whatever's going on at home. Whatever's going on in relationships in your life. For us, some of us coaches, that's parenting. That's all those things, man. All right? You've got to be able to pick that sledgehammer up and continue to swing that thing. All about pounding the rock. So they had, in the early 1900s, a journalist, he highlighted the work of a stonecutter, and they have a credo. I'm going to read it to you. When nothing seems to help, I go look at a stonecutter, hammering away his rock, perhaps 100 times without as much as a crack showing it. Hey, that's frustrating, guys. You did that for years trying to bench 225, and you finally got that. Then you're trying to squat 405, whatever it is. Every day, you're pounding away, right? Nothing's showing yet. Yet in the 101st blow, it splits into two. And I know it's not that blow that did it. It's all that had gone before it, man. That's consistent action, guys. That rock's not going to split on one swing. You're not going to win the damn lottery, man. It's every day. Consistency, guys. When they talk about Kobe, he was in the gym all the time, right? Hours before the game. Hours after the game. Steph Curry, all those guys that you hear about all the time, it's consistency, man. It's consistent action. Win the day, right? So, guys, if you haven't heard anything else I was talking about today, let me leave you this in conclusion. You've got one opportunity, man. You get one chance to play at this university. You got one chance. Work extremely hard, man, to have consistency, dependability in your life, that discipline that's required. Because I'm telling you, when you're our age, us coaches, been out a little bit longer, you can look back. There's days you may vividly remember, man. I don't know if I swung the hammer. I hid behind my sheets, man. That thing was hard. That was hard that day. And you're going to remember those days more than you are the days where you won. I'm telling you, you'll regret it. So you need to work extremely hard, make it a priority to develop that discipline. Because as I mentioned earlier, those are transferable skills. How much you bench press, the people at GE that are going to hire you, they don't care how much you bench press. But what they do care about is this. They care about you being on time. They care about you being consistent in your performance. You went into sales, they care that you hit all your numbers 1 month and then were crap the next month, right? That's the stuff that's transferable. That's the stuff that you need to challenge yourself and win this every single day. All right? Pick up your sledgehammer and pound the rock every day, man. I appreciate your time, guys.
Sit up. is guys, being consistent with your energy every day, being consistent with your effort every day. We haven't had a day yet. Where's the fucking wood? Where I've had to fucking come out there and get up somebody's ass because it's been an effort.